don't try to chase what you think your sound should be. Create the music that your soul demands you to create and follow that. Follow what you feel you should be doing, and there is an audience for that.
Welcome to The Third Story. I'm Leo Sidran. You know who you are. And that was singer-songwriter, actor, and independent music writer Ari Herstand on Finding an Audience. Ari was an innocent 19-year-old studying to be a band teacher when he took a trip to New Orleans and happened on Don Passman's book, All You Need to Know About the Music Business, which is basically a guide for musicians to understand the inner workings of their own profession. He took to the information and he loved the DIY approach to the music business. Around that same time, he also began writing his own songs and performing in coffee shops and small clubs around Minneapolis where he was going to school. He developed a live show built around looping himself on stage, playing guitar, piano, trumpet, beatboxing, and singing. Understanding the business of music and getting down to the business of writing his own music and touring constantly have turned him into one of the most published independent music bloggers today. He runs a music blog called Ari's Take and writes regularly for the popular Digital Music News blog. And later this year, his book, How to Make It in the New Music Business, will be published by Norton. You can pre-order it from his website, ariherstand.com. What began as a sideline to his music career quickly became a major part of his life. By sharing tips on how to travel, book shows, set up distribution, sell merchandise, he filled a much-needed niche. Much of this information came from his own experience touring, releasing his own records, and licensing his music for television. Ari is a sociable, extroverted, outgoing guy. He rolled up to my house in the blaze of late summer wearing corduroy bell-bottom pants and sporting his trademark Jufro mane of hair. He has a total late 60s, early 70s vibe, which has served him well in his fledgling acting career. When he appeared on the TV show Mad Men as a hitchhiker picked up by John Hamm, Entertainment Weekly wondered if he was meant to be Bob Dylan. I wanted to talk to Ari to get his sense of the state of the music business today. It feels in many ways to me like an incredibly challenging time for the business, but there are also new opportunities emerging every day. The one thing everyone seems to agree on is that it's changing. In our conversation, he talks about becoming an independent touring and recording artist and eventually music business blogger. A big part of his message is that there's an audience out there for talented people if they have the right approach, and that this is a good time for independent artists, and there are strategies that can help people. Before we get started with the conversation, here's a little taste of Ari's music. This is his song, Home Tonight. What brings you to New York on this particular trip?
To take some meetings, primarily with my book publisher. This was the first meeting with kind of the publishing team and my book agent all together in one, once now that the book is finished. So
the book is finished. Can you tell me a little bit about it?
What's it called? It's called How to Make It in the New Music Business. And the subtitle is Practical Tips on Building a Loyal Following and Making a Living as a Musician. So it's kind of based off of everything that I've written about and talked about on Ari's Take and Digital Music News. And, you know, if in Ari's Take article, I touch on some points in the book, it's like 15 pages of that Ari's Take one page concept or something. I just kind of expound on everything that I've discussed.
I want to talk about how you got into this Batman became a writer because ultimately,
I'm officially an author now, which you're is an author. Weird. I never expected that or anticipated that.
So let's talk about what you did expect and anticipate.
Sure.
I mean, I remember when you came through town 10 years ago and I went to see a showcase that you did at the Canal Room.
Oh, sure. Oh, and wow. That was my first trip, I believe, to New York. Yeah, first or second show ever in New York. Yeah.
I remember at the time a few things that you said to me, and one of them was that you were very plugged into certain movements in the business at that point. Like, you were already aware of Ingrid Michaelson having taken total control over her independent career and surviving on licenses and building a fan base that way. So I knew that you were aware of the business on a deeper level than a lot of other musicians and that you were sort of positioning yourself that way.
Yeah.
But when you decided to become a singer-songwriter, professional musician, what did you want for yourself?
I mean, I went to the University of Minnesota in the Twin Cities as a music major, as a classical trumpet / music education major. I thought I was going to be a high school band director. That's initially what I went to school to do. And that was the first year that I started writing songs on the acoustic guitar and the piano. I mean, I'd sit in the practice room where I was supposed to be practicing my trumpet scales, and I'd bang out a song on the piano because there's a piano in every practice room. And so that's when I really started songwriting. And I performed my first coffee shop show on the University of Minnesota campus there that year with all the songs that I had kind of written. And my roommate at the time was a cellist, and so he played with me that show. And my RA was a beatboxer, and the girl down the hall sang with me. So that was kind of the initial first band. Right. After that, like, the first couple coffee house shows is when I really realized that that's what I needed to do. I was only, I guess, most fulfilled when I was performing, writing, and playing music, my original music. And as much fun as I had playing an orchestra, it wasn't the same kind of high that I was getting when I was performing my original music or even songwriting. And I recorded like a little demo, and it was so exciting. And that's when I found my calling, more or less. And so I kind of broke the news to my parents that winter break that I wasn't going to be continuing at the U. And of course, my dad cried, and like, they were, you know, it's like the every Jewish parent's worst nightmare is that their kid's going to drop out of college to become a musician.
Right.
So we kind of brainstormed together, and we found the McNally Smith, which is, you know, McNally Smith. Your dad has a scholarship there, I believe.
Yes.
So I went there, and I went for music business because I knew. Well, no, I guess this is how I realized that learning music business as a musician was important. I went to the Jazz Fest in New Orleans my freshman year of college, so I was still at the U. I just so happened to pop into a Barnes & Noble with my cousin who lived there. And I went to the music section, and I saw Donald Passman's All You Need to Know About the Music Business. I'm like, oh, this looks interesting. So I bought it, and I read the whole thing in a week. And I'm like, oh, man, I get it. Like, okay, I need to learn the business if I want to have a career in music. And so that's why I kind of went to McNally to study music business. So I kind of had that intrinsically from a young age, I guess. I was 19, knowing that, like, if I want to do music professionally as a career, I need to have a strong handle on the business. And I mean, it was amazing because at the U, I skipped half my classes. I showed up hungover most of the time. I didn't really care about the stuff I was doing at the U. And I barely got by that first year. And then at McNally, I mean, I was early. I never skipped a class. I went to office hours for every teacher. I was straight A. It was just because it was, you know, I believed in what I was doing. I was really excited to learn. And I went there to learn. I didn't really go for a degree or anything like that. I just wanted to soak up as much knowledge, practical knowledge, so then I could use that for my own career.
Yeah.
And so I kind of used that as the foundation of when I launched my singer-songwriter career, I guess, right after that. I mean, it gave me the tools because at the time, this was 2004, 2005, they were still teaching the old music business. So no one really understood what was happening. There was like iTunes, but that was kind of it. And Facebook was just locked within the university system at the time. It was tiny. There was nothing really happening.
Well, and yeah, and even that Passman's book that you read was tied to the old business.
Oh, absolutely. So that was the business I knew and I understood. So at the time, I'm like, okay, I just need to get a record deal.
Yes.
So that's what I was expecting. And I'm just like, all right, well, but I like playing shows, so let's book a couple shows around campus. And then, you know, no one would show up. I'm like, huh, that's weird. Maybe we should promote the show. So I printed up posters and put up posters. And then people showed up. I'm like, oh, okay. So that's how you do it. And then I'd make flyers. And I just, it kind of grew organically that way, trial and error. And, you know, the stuff they kind of taught me in school was important, but it was more so was a guiding force to get me thinking about the business side of my music career. And not, I couldn't necessarily use a lot of what I learned practically, because a lot of was like, I took a record labels course where the entire course, the entire semester was interpreting a 120-page recording contract. Mm-hmm. I'm like, that's great, but I don't have a recording contract right now to interpret. So I was like, all right, well, how do I get people to my shows? And so I started, you know, very organically, and it grew from, you know, 20 people at a coffee shop all the way at my peak before I left. It was like 800 people to the premier clubs in Minneapolis. And that's kind of, I was like growing this thing very organically. And then I started booking tours that way. I was like, well, if I figured out how I could do this in Minneapolis, like, let's just do this in other cities too, more or less on the road. I got street teams, I engaged street teams, and I kind of hit up organizations and groups to promote. And I learned how to basically just booked the shows from all trial and error from booking the Minneapolis shows. And at some point, I think because I was touring a lot of colleges and I was touring a lot of high schools, a lot of people who would come to the shows started hitting me up like on Facebook or email and asking me very basic questions of like how, you know, how do we do these basic things like book show? Like, is this a good deal at a club? Like, how do I route a tour? How do I get songs placed on TV? Because I had a few songs at the time placed on TV shows and all the things that I'd figured out how to do. And I would answer every person. I would respond to them. And the word spread. And so then a lot of people started hitting me up. And I was just fielding multiple requests a day at that point. And I was like, man, I just don't have any time to respond to everybody. But I want to pass this knowledge on, like everything that I've learned and done kind of with my own career. Like, I want everyone, if they're willing and dedicated and passionate and hardworking enough to do it, you know. So my brother is a web developer, mm-hmm. and my best friend was a graphic design artist, so we kind of all got together and built Ari's Take, just this blog, so I could put all this stuff that I learned up on there and then just point people to it.
Yeah,
so that's kind of how it started.
I mean, the first one I was aware of, I think, yeah. independent of knowing you,
yeah.
was the article you wrote about carrying your instrument on the plane. That's got to be the biggest one.
That's
this
my first. Yeah, that was the big viral post that went crazy viral, and that kind of put Ari's Take on the map in the broader music community, I'd say. Because initially, the first year or so, it was just a lot of independent musicians passing around it, and it grew right. organically, which was great. I mean, I didn't actually necessarily expect it to grow as big as it kind of did, especially not initially, because I kind of just put it up as something that artists could use, you know, as a tool. And I just wanted to help them out and give them a way to gain this knowledge that also wasn't out there. And that was another thing at the time, because all the music business books that were on the market, none of them discussed the new music industry that we were existing in at the time. And like, especially like Passman's book is great and I learned a lot from it, but it doesn't tell you how to book a tour on your own or book a show or what a good deal is at the door or how to sell more merch. Like, how do you double your merch sales? Like, you know.
But at what point did it come into focus for you that this is actually a big part of the business of Ari Herstand, is this information?
I realized as Ari's Take started to grow organically and people started asking for like one-on-one consulting, I was like, well, I guess, like, sure. And I, you know, I don't have the time. If I'm going to devote the time to this, I'm going to charge for it. So I started like setting up consulting sessions. It even got to a point where like music tech startups were contacting me to just like advise a little bit,
right.
Because I was kind of digging into the broader music industry for a while. Like I that was the only real way for the first couple of years that I was earning anything from this, all this business knowledge, really, was occasional consulting sessions when people would ask me to help them out one-on-one.
Yeah.
After that viral Carry Your Instrument on the Plane post,
right.
Digital Music News got in touch and they became aware of me because of that article. But then he read a lot of the articles on the blog and he basically offered me a writing position there. And he said, we'd love to have you write for us. And it was great because it was like, write as much or as little as you want. Here are the keys to the site and just go. And so that was when I started to, you know, make money on my business knowledge and doing that. They pay me for an article and everything. And it was cool. But this revenue stream that I never expected, anticipated, or chased, or even this field, this profession, I suppose, it just kind of kept growing organically. And then a lot of the Digital Music News articles, because their platform and the base is so big, a lot of my articles started going viral. And like within the first, I think, 6 months, I think I had the top 50 articles of the site of all time. I think I had like 20 of them or something, which was crazy.
Do you own the intellectual property content of those articles, or when they pay you for them, do they become the property of?
That's a really good question. And we had to deal with this with the book publisher. We had to get permission from Digital Music News to use some of the stuff because some of the articles I use sentences or paragraphs from in the book.
Yeah.
It's not a lot. I'd say there's probably 80% all new content that I wrote from scratch. And then the 20% are bits and pieces from other articles and things that I'd come up with.
Because there's similar kinds of issues that we face as musicians when we license sell. And
no,
what, you know,
totally.
You know, it strikes me, Ari, that you set out to be a musician and a songwriter, and you are.
Uh-huh.
And you focused all of this attention into your career to do that. And then there's this strange thing that happened that it turns out that the thing that you had no idea was going to lead you forward was actually the thing that generated as much, if not more, interest than your actual music career.
You know, I had a solid fan base. You know, it's never as big as you want it to be.
Yeah.
Very happy with what I've done. But at the same time, like, I have not reached the scale that my articles have reached. Like, some of my articles, I mean, collectively, I've gotten millions of views on these articles, and there's not a single one of my songs that has a million plays, you know? So it's weird. And I can play all these mind tricks with myself, and I do, and you can go through spirals of like, well, maybe my music's not as good, or yada, 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 whatever. But then you kind of put it in perspective, and it's like, well, there's a niche and there's an area for everything. And the thing is, the difference between what I've done with Ari's Take and Digital Music News and the business side is that I filled a void. There was no one providing this information who was also a working artist. Like, all the tips articles at the time that were out there were by companies looking to gain customers, or the books written by lawyers. No one was in the trenches doing it.
Right.
And so because I was touring so much and booking all my own tours, and because I was contacting music supervisors to get my songs placed and they got placed, and because I was kind of doing it all on the ground, and everything, every time I learned something, I would write about it and say, hey, I just learned this, do this or don't do this, or I screwed up here, don't make sure you don't screw up the way I just screwed up or something, you know. And so it's kind of like real time, and I think that's why it kind of grew on the level it did.
Right. There were far fewer people doing what you were doing, or nobody,
right,
in that world, as opposed to
in
the world
of
singer-songwriters.
Exactly. A lot of acoustic singer-songwriters. All that kind of turned into the book deal. And I went to New Orleans to write the book. I spent a month there. I lived in my cousin's guest. It kind of came full circle now that I think about it. I didn't really piece it together until right now, but I bought Donald Passon's book in New Orleans when I was there visiting for the Jazz Fest. And then I ended up writing the book, my book, in New Orleans, just because I needed to get out of LA. I couldn't concentrate in LA with all the distractions. And my cousin happened to have a guest house in New Orleans. Like, had he had a guest house in Omaha, Nebraska, I would have probably gone there. But I was thrilled it was in New Orleans.
Sure.
But because I was there writing, I would write for 10 hours a day, and then I'd go out and see music every night. And I was so inspired by the music there, all the funk bands and the horn bands and everything like that, that kind of guided me. Now I'm working on a funk project. So it's like I'm kind of putting the singer-songwriter thing on hold right now as I pursue this new funk band. And
cool.
It's just like, yeah, it's weird how certain things can kind of direct you in different areas and down different avenues.
How did you find your writing voice as a writer of words, of prose? You know, you worked so much as a musician to find that voice. I'm curious how somebody who really didn't study writing or think of themselves as a writer, how did you find that voice and that tone?
I'd always written a little bit here and there, and when I launched Ari's Take, I started with I think 20 articles, 20 posts. And so I spent a while just kind of putting these things together and having fun with that. And what was important to me was to make it very conversational and talk to musicians like musicians talk, like we talk.
Yeah.
And that was the thing that was really difficult when I read a lot of these tips articles, is like my eyes would glaze over when I'm reading stuff from lawyers and they're trying to be cute. And they're just being annoying or condescending or patronizing, is how I found a lot of the articles. It's like they couldn't figure out how to talk in a way that musicians could understand without being patronizing about it.
Yeah.
That's how they're wired or something. And they just don't hang, you know, they're not at the club at 1 a.m. morning, you know, after the set, shooting the shit about what went down and how they didn't get paid, what they thought they were going to get paid. And so it's like, I basically just put everything into that as just, I made my tone musician, and that's the tone of all the writing, I guess, is just talk like musicians talk and not try to be fake about it.
Conversational
and just open. I mean, because I wasn't writing for anybody, I didn't have to worry about a copy editor or an editor at all really coming in and saying, no, swear less, like, we're not, you know, or don't.
So did you have to deal with that when you wrote the book?
Oh my gosh. Yeah. That was some of those, like, the most stressful part of this entire book writing process.
See, I think editors are basically like producers, but I think they're way more heavy-handed than producers are.
So to my editor's credit, my editor is amazing, and he gave me just broad general things to potentially tighten up a little bit. It was fantastic. He gave me very few notes, and he said my manuscript was in a really strong place. Then we passed it on to copy editors. They did an incredible job. They, like, every page, every line, they had something, but it was all stuff. I needed that. I really wanted that. I was really appreciative that the copy editors came in and did that, because no one else read this book. I gave it a couple passes, but I missed stuff all over the place. But where I had the really biggest difficulty and the biggest struggle was with the attorney. There was a lawyer assigned to my book. She was contracted out by Norton. And we spent 2 months going back and forth, the littlest things, just because, I mean, she came in to prevent, you know, a libel suit or just being sued for anything. I mean, like, I couldn't even say that, like, said, oh, these two companies are the easiest way to design a website on your own right now. You should check them out. She's like, well, you can't say that because there are other companies out there. I'm like, yeah, but this, you know, she's like, that's your,
in my opinion, in my research?
Well, the whole book's my opinion, but that was the other thing, is just like, this is an opinion book. I mean, it's, you know, that was what I was just so confused about, is like, easy is a subjective term. Like, if I think it's the easiest, that's my opinion, clearly. And I don't know. So, you know, it's usually, they were just very cautious, because I think more so now than they were 20 years ago, because I think there's so many more lawsuits these days or something. I don't know. So we struggled and we battled. And
by the way, what, in your opinion, what are the two easiest websites to build your own site on now?
Banzoogle and Squarespace. I've experimented with both, and they're both fantastic. Yeah.
Maybe I should try to get Banzoogle to sponsor my podcast, because Squarespace is sponsoring every other podcast out there.
I
need to get into Banzoogle business.
I'll put you in touch. I'm close with those people. They're good people. Banzoogle and Squarespace, they're great. And that's the thing. I mean, there's a lot of great tools out there. And because that was the one thing when I started writing for Digital Music News, is it gave me access to a lot of companies and a lot of people that I didn't have the access just being some dude with a blog before.
Yeah.
So, like, I got to talk to people high up at Spotify, and I got to talk to people. So I got kind of top to bottom, left to right in the music industry, like, on a granular level, like, how do we design a website that doesn't cost an arm and a leg? Banzoogle. But, like, you know, also top level, okay, how do we understand how to obtain our mechanical royalties when we don't have a publisher?
Yes.
You know, and it's like, there's those kinds of things. And musicians, they're equally important to musicians, but there aren't too many guides out there that can help you with both. So I kind of made it my thing with the book and with everything I talk about it, to just like, if you're an indie artist, this is everything really that you should know, and not all you need to know, but definitely what you should know.
Yes.
And this will give you the tools to hopefully, you know, jumpstart your career to the next level.
Folks, have you been wondering how to create an affordable website that looks great for your band? Check out Bandzoogle. It's an online platform that provides tools for musicians to build a professional website, promote their music, and sell direct to fan for an affordable flat monthly fee. It includes a built-in store, mailing list tools, reporting, and integration with social networks and services, including Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Bandcamp, and SoundCloud. Choose from dozens of responsive design themes and customize them using Bandzoogle's robust but easy-to-use design tool. The platform allows artists to keep a record of their sales and requires no knowledge of HTML coding. Ari Herstand, author of How to Make It in the New Music Business, says, Bandzoogle is fantastic. When it comes to your website, don't be bamboozled. Try Bandzoogle. Ari Herstand believes this is a great time in the music business. Here he talks about his feelings about why that is, why labels aren't the holy grail for artists anymore, the value of managers, and finding 1,000 true fans. Is there a middle class in the music business? How has crowdfunding through sites like Pledge Music and Kickstarter changed the landscape? This is it, folks. This is the meaty, informational, enlightening, nourishing part of our experience here today. Check it out.
So, I mean, I have so many questions about how you view the business today.
Sure.
But I'm also totally aware of the fact that you have all of this information about where the, let's say, the middle class business is, where the life is, mm-hmm. where the potential career is. And at the same time, in your own personal life, the guy who has all the information, mm-hmm. the answer is not by making music.
No, so I would say that's not true. That was a conscious decision on my part to put more effort into this side. I think it's a phenomenal time for the music industry. I talk to so many people, probably every week. I have three Skype conversations with people at companies, at startups, at the, you know, Spotify or whomever, everywhere. And like ASCAP, I mean, top to bottom, left to right, labels, you name it, managers, everything. It is an extremely exciting time in the music industry right now for independent artists. And that's the thing, is just like what gets lost, the voice that gets lost right now are what's happening on the ground. Like Chance the Rapper happened overnight, it seemed, and nobody like could understand what's going on. It's like, he must have a ghost label behind him. He doesn't have a ghost label behind him, you know? And I mean, like, you know, say what you want about Macklemore, but a similar kind of thing, you know, eventually, yeah, they teamed up with a distributor who helped him out a little bit, but they didn't come from the ground and like make him famous because they heard a demo or a mixtape. Same with, you know, Ingrid Michaelson was like still, but she was one of the first, I would say, where her manager, Lynn Grossman, picked Ingrid up from MySpace from back in the day, 2007. And just they kind of forged her career together outside of the traditional music industry. So if you only pay attention to the headlines on Billboard, then it is a very depressing place right now. And it's a lot of doomsday talk, and everyone's so depressed recently about the DOJ decision that just came out a couple days ago. And it's like, you know, when you really break it down to the core of what's happening, it's a very bright future. But the way that artists are going to be making money in the future and right now are, yes, by diversifying their income stream and by thinking differently about how to approach a music career, about an independent music career. And it's not getting the major label deal is not the holy grail anymore. I would advise everyone to run away from the labels as fast as you can, because the chances of you quote unquote making it are much greater on your own than at a label, believe it or not. I mean, that's just how it is. But people, the ones who chase the labels are the ones who don't want to put in the work on their own. And the irony is, the labels only want to sign artists who've already put the work in. Exactly. So, you know, there's a ton of artists out there who just make, you know, one good song or one good EP or something like that. And it was like, all right, I'm ready to get signed. It's like, well, that's not how it works. Like, no label wants to sign you. You know, they want to sign Halsey, who she built up her entire enterprise on her own and released her first song because she'd been building it for, you know, 8 years online. And then she releases a song and that goes crazy viral. And, you know, they want to sign her, and they did. And, you know, they want to sign artists who figured out how to do it on their own. So, you know, whether once you get to that level where you have a substantial fan base and you've really figured it out on your own, that's when the labels start approaching, and that's when you need to be even stronger to say, no, I got this and I can do it. And like, there are the tools out there to do it. But right. Getting back to the state of the music industry, well, we're in a transitional period right now. No one really has the answers, and everyone in the music industry, the macro industry, has been playing catch up for 10 years. I didn't go searching for an additional revenue stream outside of music, or I guess Ari's Take and digital music is still within the music industry, but it's not with my own music like I earn from everything else. I decided to consciously to devote my time and energies there because I saw how many musicians were gaining from this and how important it was to so many musicians. And I saw that people needed this and they really were appreciative of it. So I made the decision to stay off the road longer than I normally had.
And you were doing, before this, you were doing 100 dates a year. What were you
doing? Yeah, at least. Right. I was 6 months collectively for 5 or 6 years on the road.
Yeah.
You're right. It was intense. That's kind of how I focused my career. And that's the beautiful thing about the new music industry, is that there isn't just one way to do it anymore. Whereas 15 years ago, there was basically one path that everybody followed. It's like, you get a deal, you know, you get a record deal, you hire your booking agent, you hit the road, you release your record, you release a single, you know, before, and they push a radio, on and on and on. But it was very cookie cutter. And it was very, whether you were a folk band or you were the next, you know, Lady Gaga, they promoted you basically the same way. Yes. And it didn't make any sense, but that's just how they did it because that's all they knew how to do. And the labels are still kind of stuck in that system of, we only really know how to make you a superstar. And most of the time it doesn't work out, but 1 in 100 it does. Right. So that pays our bills and everything like that. Whereas nowadays there's literally 100 or 1,000 different ways that your music career can follow if you're independent.
Yes.
And then you find what makes sense for you. So part of my strengths was understanding the business, and I really enjoy helping other musicians. And like, it broke my heart in Minneapolis, every band that was so talented, and I saw them get screwed over by a label, or I saw them, you know, break up because of dumb business decisions or something like that. And some of my favorite bands of all time were the local bands of Minneapolis. Yes. I was playing around town with. And yeah, some of them got major label deals, some of them got indie label deals, some of them toured a lot, and all of them broke up. And it broke my heart to see that. I'm like, I don't want this to happen anymore. So, you know, I made the decision to kind of take time off the road. And once digital music news kind of came up, and I was writing a lot, and was like, okay, well, I have a revenue stream here that I'm going to use for the time being while, you know, I develop my next musical project and everything like that. And you have to devote, and you have your time and your efforts to your strengths. And like, I would encourage every musician to use your creative talents, whatever they are, and pursue those, and to find, you know, what makes the most sense for you. Getting back to kind of like, I'm launching this new funk band, and it's almost going to be a practice what you preach kind of thing, because I'm going to be launching this project from scratch, from the ground up. You know, I'm going to be using everything that I talk about in how to really launch a band and kind of get it off the ground and get started and going.
Well, it does seem to me that a big part of the credibility of the voice is, I'm out here doing it. And the second you lose touch with that, I mean, it's great that you're talking to Spotify and ASCAP every week, but you also need to be able
But I'm an artist in it. And that, first and foremost, I'm an artist. And that's, yes, it's the credibility thing, but more so than anything, like, that's where I'm happiest, I guess, and most fulfilled. And that's where I feel at home. I don't think I could ever stop writing, like songwriting. Yeah. I don't think I could ever stop performing. I mean, I have an extreme itch right now to get back on the road, but I have that empathy that I think a lot of former artists tend to lose, especially if they came up in a different era. Like, there's a lot of these talking heads out there in the music industry, kind of giving advice columns and stuff like that, who were signed to a major label in the 80s or something like that. And it's like, okay, that's cool. Like, you have that, you know, but everyone was signed to a major label in the 80s. I mean, it's like, all right,
well,
that's
yes,
great.
And but at the same time, there were fewer. I mean, that's one of the things I think about is that if you made a record in the 80s, there was no way to make a record without a deal.
Yeah. Yeah.
For forever.
Right, right. Absolutely. It almost seems a little disingenuous when they say, oh, I'm an artist. It's like, well, you're not really. Like, you're not having to put yourself out there in today's world and suffer through the 1,000 YouTube comments that tell you to go eat a pile of shit, like, which I have.
So that's the interesting thing. And at the same time, I've also seen comments on Ari's take where people say, but this is, assumes a lot about what kind of person I am. Like, first of all, if am I the kind of person who can do these things that you say?
Yes.
Do I have the personality? Am I an agreeable, you know, charming, socially? Because a lot of the people that are compelled to make music may not be the kinds of people who are compelled to these things.
Absolutely. And you know, no one can do everything on their own. Yeah. So you find what your strengths are and you run with those strengths. And that's why it's important. If you have a band, you find like whoever in the band is the most charismatic and the most sociable person. That's your networker. That's the one who you send off and they're schmoozing and they're the ones that are gaining the contacts and everything like that. Maybe your drummer is an introvert, hates that stuff, doesn't want to deal with people, but is an amazing graphic design artist. So maybe your drummer does all the graphic design work. You know, so you want to delegate these duties. But also if you're a solo artist, team up with someone who, you know, I guess that's what a manager is, really.
Well, I was going to ask you, have you had management? Do you have a manager? Have you had a manager at any point?
Not officially. Currently, one of my closest friends in LA, actually is from Milwaukee. He is a manager at Red Light Management, who I've had my eye on ever since high school because I was a Dave Matthews fanatic in high school and was started by Corn Capshaw, Dave Matthews' manager. And now they're the largest management company in the world with hundreds of artists. And he hit me up in LA saying, hey, we're both music people from Wisconsin in LA. I've been reading your stuff. And so that was like 2-3 years ago, and we become super close. And unofficially, we're kind of working together. We're launching this project together. So he's kind of, I guess, my unofficial manager right now. Yeah. But over the years, no. I mean, there was a time when I really desperately wanted a manager.
Yeah.
And I couldn't figure out how to get one. And I remember very vividly this conversation I had with Jay Nash, singer-songwriter. When he passed through Minneapolis, we went out for Vietnamese, and I told him, like, listen, Jay, you know, I'm pulling 800 people locally. I got, you know, I was giving my numbers and all my marks. I'm like, I got 200 in Chicago. I'm pulling 300 in Madison. I got 200 in Milwaukee. Yeah. I'm playing Summerfest every year. Like, why can't I find a manager? Like, why isn't, you know, I don't understand. And he's like, listen, Ari, you don't find a manager. A manager finds you.
Yeah.
It's interesting because there's some truth to that. And it was only, you know, when it kind of happens. The best managers, those kinds of situations happen kind of organically. It's when the manager can, quote unquote, discover their artist and then they have something invested in them. Because if you bang on a manager's door saying, hey, work with me, they think, of course they want to work with me because I'm awesome and everyone wants to work with me.
Right.
So I don't know about you. But if it goes the other way around, if they hear you at the dentist's office while, you know, that like getting their tooth pulled, they're like, well, who is this? Like, oh, it's a demo that my daughter gave me of her friend's band. And then you discover them, and it could be the exact same person.
Well,
it's
the hand in the relationship. We've got the upper hand in the relationship.
Yeah. So, you know, a lot of people, without having a manager, it's debilitating and they give up, or they, you know, if you can't find a manager, it's like, well, I just must not be good, or, you know, no one wants to work with me, or it's just tough to find that. So, you know, I just used that as another obstacle or just another job I had to take on, which was fine, but I passed off other jobs.
Yeah.
So it's like you want to know which jobs you can pass off and which ones that, you know, you're good at and you should hold on. I happen to be an extrovert, and I happen to be good communicating with people and going out there, and that I enjoy doing that. So that's a strength that I have that a lot of artists don't have.
Yeah.
Which is what a manager typically does, and, you know, making the connections and making the deals and everything. And I was good. I learned how to make the deals and make those connections. And so I was able to do that. So I didn't necessarily need a manager. I realized after some point, I'm like, man, I have gotten over 100 press articles. I've had my songs placed on, I think, 30 TV shows, a couple commercials, films. I've played over 600 shows. I've opened for massive stars. I've done all these things without a manager and without a booking agent. It's like, well, I guess not having a manager necessarily wasn't something that I guess I needed to succeed at, on some level, yeah. You know? So I would have, of course, loved to have one because just to say you got a manager, right? But now when people say I have a manager, I'm just like, let's talk about your manager.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, part of the reason I thought about it was because the labels are not doing the work that labels used to do.
Right.
Or there's maybe they are continuing
to
do this.
There's no development anymore.
But what I'm seeing is a lot of managers, production developers, mm-hmm. people that are trying to develop talent
yes.
and help put all of those assets in place and mm-hmm. all of those pieces in place out from under the umbrella of a label system.
Absolutely.
So there's a new kind of manager also who's kind of emerged and
yeah.
is providing, I think, a lot of these label services or development services.
Absolutely. I mean, the manager is becoming the most important person. I mean, it's always been a very, very important person on your team, but is the most important and powerful person to have and as a part of your team. And the manager is the one who really pushes everything forward. And so, you know, the managers basically fall into two categories. You have your best friend manager who's young, doesn't know anything about the business, but will scream at the top of every building for you. And then you have the well-connected manager who works at, you know, a large management company, has been in the business for years and years and years, and can make one phone call and accomplish, you know, something in 5 minutes that your best friend manager would take 6 months to do.
Right.
So you have like those two managers that fall in these two different camps. And the biggest asset that the best friend manager has that you don't have is not being you, because it's very difficult to be your own, to be an advocate for yourself. And I learned that, you know, and I've even created an alias at some point because I'm just like, man, no one is taking me seriously. So right.
Different email address,
everything, different name, different email address. Absolutely. I had that. I don't know if I don't really use it anymore now because, you know, people kind of know who I am and I've just built up these relationships and contacts
Getting
started for certain situations, it was helpful. You know, I don't necessarily recommend everybody do that. I ran into some muddy waters at some point with that. I kind of got caught in a big lie with my alias manager, and it was really uncomfortable for everybody involved. So I don't know. You got to think about that. But you know, teaming up with the manager and having that as your teammate and your cheerleader, but also the person that's going to help focus and guide your career outside of the label system. I mean, that's really what's happening these days. I mean, there are so many artists that are just bubbling up right now that we're going to start to really see in the next 5 years that are going to be competing at the same scale that the major label artists are competing. And then even below that, and that's just without labels at all, totally independent.
Yeah.
Because it's possible. The tools are there. That you don't need the label system anymore, the structure to do anything. You know, those gates have come down. But at the same time, we're also starting to see, and this never gets reported on in the industry, we're seeing a lot of these indie artists who are middle-class musicians.
Well, this is what I want to know about. Tell me about this. Because I've been saying for years, where's the middle class?
There is a middle class, and it's thriving, and it's getting bigger. So as you know, before there was really like superstars or starving artists. That's kind of how it'd been for a long time. And now we're kind of getting to this point where there are many more middle class musicians, because the thing is like, you don't need the scale like you needed before. So you've heard the thing where they say 1,000 true fans,
yeah.
where if you get 1,000 true fans to pay you $100 a year,
yes.
that's $100,000. That's all you need for your entire yes. career. So that holds truth. And more so now than ever, because of the tools that we have, the engagement tools, if you can grab 1,000, you don't even need 1,000. I mean, sure, 1,000 people at $100, but what about 500 people at $200 or $300? You can do it with that as well. And there's different levels of patronage that are happening these days. And so that's where the middle class is existing right now, is they're not topping the charts. They're not getting millions of views on YouTube. They're not getting millions of plays on Spotify. But, you know, they're existing in this middle category where maybe they're playing to 50 to 100 people a night. Some cities more. They're doing living room concerts. They're getting songs synced on TV shows. I mean, there's a lot of artists. Like, the sync community, I'm sure you know very well, is thriving right now. Like, I have so many friends in LA and actually some in Minneapolis who they never play shows. They're a band and they're musicians, and they make six figures just on sync placements. And they don't want to play shows. They have families and everything. They don't have day jobs.
It's interesting that you said also this idea of, you know, whatever it is, 500 fans, 1500 fans, somewhere mm-hmm. in there. And I read an article that you wrote that where you said, you know, there's no shame in knowing your audience's last names.
Yeah,
which absolutely. Is to say, just because they're your friends doesn't right. mean they're not your fans. Mm-hmm. Because I think I was misguided for a long time in thinking early on with crowd-funded projects, my friends would say to me, you think I should do it, or I'm thinking about doing it. And my initial read on it was, you can do one. You know, that's what I would tell people. Mm-hmm. You can choose the one that you really want to do. And as it turns out, I was misguided in yeah. the sense that once you have people invested yes. in your career and they feel tied to you, mm-hmm. you can actually come back again and again and again.
Oh, and Pledge Music has come out with a number saying that every following campaign that artists run, they make more money. Without fail, the second campaign makes more money, the third campaign makes even more money than that, and the more the requisite campaigns that they run, actually they get more fans.
So what do you attribute money. This to? I mean, I guess just thinking off the top of my head, as an artist, mm-hmm. it's so hard to cut through the noise.
Yes.
But as a listener, it's so hard to cut through the noise also and figure right. out what you care about.
Absolutely. And I think it's really at the core of it is, don't try to chase what you think your sound should be. Create the sound, create the music that is what your soul demands you to create, and follow that. Follow what you feel you should be doing. And there is an audience for that. There is absolutely an audience for it. And it's finding that audience. And it's easier, it's now easier than ever to find that audience. I mean, I think, you know, Spotify Discover Weekly is the most brilliant thing to come out, and it's a godsend right now, because that is enabling fans who don't know what to do, how to discover artists, to find these new artists. And I mean, playlists in general, there have been artists that completely unknown artists with day jobs that get their songs included in playlists, and they, because they're popular playlists, they get millions of plays, and they start to get, you know, hundreds or thousands of yeah. fans because of that. So, you know, that's an interesting way, but there are other ways to find your fans, and there's no one way, again, to do it, because it's you find the communities that make sense. So it's not just about the music either. It's everything around the music.
Maybe that's the biggest change. I mean, on the one hand, you had these artists who were used to having all this stuff done for them.
Yes.
But there was also division of labor, in the same way that there was between engineers and artists, mm-hmm. and the same way there was in all of what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if we were having this conversation for a radio show 10 years ago,
sure.
we wouldn't be doing it in my living room.
Right, exactly.
And there would be a guy who was recording yep. it, and there would be all of this infrastructure. Yes. And if you were going to start a newsletter mm-hmm. or some kind of a publishing career 15 years ago, there would have been all of these hurdles, obstacles between you and the work.
Absolutely. And it's for better or worse, because, you know, if something blocked you and prevented you from, you know, learning Pro Tools
yes.
or learning how to set up microphones yep. or how outboard gear works or yep. anything like that, if it's just something inside of you is like, I can't do this, I'm a songwriter yes. or I'm a drummer, like yes. that's all I do, you know, you wouldn't be where you are right now.
Right.
But at the core, really what it is, as an artist, from an artist standpoint, is understanding what your artist vision is and what is important to you creatively, but also in the human aspect, because so much of what fans connect to with artists is authenticity, and they want to dig deeper. It's not just the song that they like, you yeah. know, that's what pop radio is. And that's not what artists should be you know, striving for,
yeah.
aspiring to be, because that's shallow, because they're fans of pop radio. Whatever they get fed, it's like, okay, that was fun, that's exciting. They don't care about who the artist is. But when you're looking for right. your
pop radio
niche,
is the asset on pop radio,
yes.
not the artist. That's interesting. I never thought about it, but it's true.
It's true. People tune into pop radio to be fed what they know that they're going to be fed, and it's yeah. exciting and it's fun. But yeah. you know, they so rarely really dig into the artists on a deep level. but it's these subgenres, the sub communities, these hidden pockets here and there that artists are tapping into. Once they really understand, and it is very difficult for artists to get to the point where they present to the world basically an unadulterated, you know,
naked.
Yes, total naked of like, this is who I am as an artist, yeah. And I'm proud of it,
yeah.
And I don't give a fuck about anything else, and, you know, take it or leave it, and there's an audience for that. And whatever level of brashness you want to go with it, I mean, there are some sensitive singer-songwriters like, this is who I am. You know, there are some balls-to-the-wall rock artists like, this is who I am, this is what I'm doing. And there are some very politically charged, you know, folk acts or whomever, everything. And yeah. And it's like, if you have that understanding and aren't trying to whitewash your career to what you think this label system or pop radio system
wants you to be.
Ari Herstand, keeping it real and advocating for authenticity. Folks, I want to be authentic with you. I do give a fuck about something other than myself. I care about the hopes, fears, and ideas that motivate all of us. And I care about you. That's why I record another new conversation and post it every other week on third-story.com. You can visit the site to subscribe, sign up to the mailing list, and check out all of the previous conversations. One of the questions that comes up often is how to balance artistic truth in relation to making a living. And in the case of Ari Herstand, it's no exception. After moving to LA, Ari started to expand his reach yet again by delving into, wait for it, as my 5-year-old daughter would say, you might be surprised, acting. He already had the right disposition for it, and his look is so specific. If a casting agent were looking for a hippie, surfer, musician, long-haired Jew, he'd be a serious contender. In his short acting career, he's appeared on Mad Men, Transparent, several sitcoms. Considering this, it seemed like a fair question when I asked him, what is acting? His answer was beautiful and revealing.
You were deeply influenced, and you wear it, you wear your heart on your sleeve and your yeah. roots very clearly by Madison and then by Minneapolis.
Uh-huh.
And you moved to LA.
Yes.
And something locked in for you when you got to LA that wasn't going to lock in for you in Minneapolis, that was somehow tied to image, and that you could be an actor. Mm-hmm. You could sort of exist in this other world. There was more for you than just being a road musician.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that would have ever locked in for you if you stayed in Minneapolis.
I don't think so. I mean, when I left Minneapolis, I was very narrowly focused on my music career, and I had these blinders on, and I was following a trajectory that I had set out for myself years prior, and I was just trying to stay on this line that I thought I wanted to follow, and I was very blocked off or closed off to any other potential opportunities that didn't fall rigidly in line with the path that I had set out. So, you know, in Minneapolis, if anyone had offered me an opportunity to act or something like that, or to write, I'd be like, no, that's not what I'm doing. This is like, I gotta keep concentrating and focusing on that. But what I realize is by opening myself up, and it's almost like a survival mechanism for people in LA, because LA is so expensive, and you're just like, but there's also a lot of money in LA, and there's a lot of work, but there's a lot of people, and you just have to use all of your creative talents, all of them, to survive in LA. And so...
So you didn't feel you had to specialize. You felt you had to diversify.
Yeah, I felt I had to diversify for sure. The first couple years I was there, I was just doing what I knew how to do. I was touring all the time. And it was kind of a bummer because I wanted to get to know the scene, and I wanted to find my scene in LA. But I had structured my career in a way that I made most of my money on the road, and I intentionally structured it that way because I loved touring and I wanted it that way. But then that was a challenge to figure out, okay, now if I spend more time in LA to build up a scene here and to really understand why I'm here in LA, I have to figure out alternative ways to make money.
Right.
Ironically, acting came from that. I'm like, well, I used to act in high school. I kind of enjoy doing that, you know, and my girlfriend had at the time taken a commercial acting class. She's like, why don't you send out some headshots, and commercials can pay pretty good money as an actor. I'm like, oh, that'd be cool. Why not? Like, you know, so I did that, and then it turned into something more. And then I'm sitting with John Hamm in a car.
What's amazing about that is it looks like you didn't even go through wardrobe. It looks like they put you on the, like you walked onto the set and they said, great, you made it. You're here. Go stand there. Like you got cast as you, essentially.
Yeah. It's funny because there's a TV show coming out in a month that I'm in. Another 1970, it's called Aquarius, David Duchovny's new show. And it's like, if you got a show from 1968 to 1974, I'm your man. Going on so many auditions and seeing what works and how casting directors and producers and directors are able to, how they conduct the auditions and then who gets cast and the understanding that they have with what that actor is capable of doing based on the way they present themselves when they walk in the room. There's parallels in the music industry.
I mean, you're sitting here right now with a life in the music industry, a life in the publishing industry, and a life in the world of acting.
Yeah.
Are they basically the same place?
They all come from the same place for sure. I mean, it's still all me. I mean, I don't feel that I am drastically changing who I am in any whenever I'm on a different medium. It's just creating art through a different medium. And so that's something I realized when I first started acting, when I was terrified. It was 4 years ago, and I sent out headshots on a whim, and I got called the next day from a very large acting agent, and because of my look, because of my hair, she's like, I don't even know if you can act, but I can get you in the room based on your look. I'm like, well, that's encouraging. I'm a fucking artist. Like, what are you telling me this for? But like, so I was terrified. I'm like, wow, gosh, what do I do? Like, I don't want to get by in my look. That's like, you know. So I contacted an actor friend of mine. He gave me like 12 acting books that I needed to read. And what these books helped me understand, I basically gave myself a master's class in acting in like a month, because I needed to just like, I needed to get myself to a place where I understood what acting was.
What is acting?
It's truth. It is helping tell a story, and it is, it is bringing truth to a situation. And that's what all art is, though, really. You know, that's what music is, and that's what writing is. And so once I understood that, okay, I just, you know, I'm not going to express myself with an acting like I do when I'm writing singer-songwriter songs, but I can put myself into that person's shoes and understand and put, get that in my headspace. And it's not about like, should I look over to the right at this point, or should I raise my arm here, or should I get louder at this point? You know, that's very surface kind of motions that a lot of young actors, I think, kind of work on and practice. And it's like, it's not about that at all. It's just like, do you believe in what you're doing right now? And if you believe in that, they'll believe you.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of what I learned.
I like that it's truth, coming into contact with truth, tuning into truth, because like everything we talk about, like the details are the details, and those are just reality. Like, I'm going to have to say these words. Somehow they're going to come out of my mouth.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to play these songs. I'm going to have to deliver this message, this content here. But tuning into truth, I really dig. What did John Hamm think of you?
We had a great time. We, believe it or not, our little 2-minute scene took 6 hours to shoot. So we had a lot of downtime, and he taught me cribbage, that old game, because I guess he said he learned it on the job, I guess, to get into that kind of headspace. But so we spent a long time just kind of playing some cards, and it was a good time. He was super chill, very friendly for that one.
And then you had to keep it quiet for a year.
Yeah, I couldn't tell anyone. That was very difficult.
Did you tell your parents?
I accidentally told my parents, my aunt, and my girlfriend when I got the call that I got the part on Mad Men. But I had, it was the table read like the next day or 2 days later, where the entire cast, a lot of the crew, and the creator, Matthew Weiner, we were all there. And Matt Weiner stood up And he said, you know, welcome to our family. We're really happy that you're here. The reason, you know, one of the reasons the show has done so well is because of its secrecy. So we ask you don't tell anybody about this. You don't post it anywhere.
And he must have done this at every table.
Probably. Right? And he's like, if we find out that you told anybody that you're even on the show, you will be dismissed. And I don't think he meant from the show. I think he meant in general.
You will be disappeared.
Yeah. So from that, I'm like, oh gosh, I called my parents and like, just, you can't tell right. anybody. And that's extremely difficult for my mother. But
right. Yeah, it would be for mine too. So I also saw a video of you teaching the cast of Transparent a yeah. bunch of Jewish folk songs.
Right,
camp
right.
songs.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Jill Soloway is like a Wisconsin person. The creator of Transparent went to UW.
I didn't know that. Yeah. She's sitting next to me when we were teaching them. Oh, my gosh. Well, I'll have to tell her next time I see her. Because I play music at Wilshire Boulevard Temple in L.A. in Koreatown twice a month. We've created this whole new adult alternative service called Nefesh with Rabbi Susan Goldberg. It's super chill. It's three acoustic guitars, cajon. It's like this really alternative service, very hip, very progressive. And Rabbi Susan is very close with Jill. And a lot of the cast and crew from Transparent come to our services. And they actually created a character after David, who is the Israeli, one of the other guys yeah. in the band. And they created this new character on the show called David. And so there was this episode where they needed to sing Hinei Matov
yeah.
and a few other there was a Havdalah yeah. episode. And so they asked us to come in and basically teach them Hinei Matov and mm-hmm. a couple other songs. And we were going to do Debbie Friedman's Havdalah.
Yeah.
And then the day of, we taught everyone how that went, the Debbie Friedman's Havdalah. And we, you know, practiced with that, rehearsed. And then the day of, they couldn't get the rights to it, to the song. And so the director frantically comes up to us like probably 15 minutes before we were going to start the first rehearsal. She's like, we couldn't get the rights. Do you have a Havdalah song that we can do for the episode?
Wow.
And David, he had an original Havdalah song because he's in this band called Moshav Band, and they do a lot of like kind of Jewish original music. And so we just had this nigun, this Havdalah nigun, and we all just were lying together. And the entire cast was there. It was one of these episodes where it was the entire cast, a bunch of extras, and we're all kind of lying together. And Jeffrey Tambor is great, you know, and lying along to all of this. And that was a lot of fun. So that's and we're in that episode. So we were just brought in to teach them the song. And then Jill's like, well, actually, you guys, you should be the band in this episode. And that's a show. That's one of the few. That's, I think, the only show that I've been cast in that I actually watch. So that was really exciting for me. Yeah.
There is something very familiar in how dysfunctional the relationships and the friendships are, and also the way the Jewiness of it that just feels texturally familiar to me.
Yeah.
Even though I think that there are some really self-destructive people on the show, there
sure.
is something about it that also does the flavor of it is
flavor.
Like is the flavor that I'm familiar with.
Yeah, and that's because in part because of Jill. And because of Rabbi Susan, who is on hand. So the rabbi in the show, Catherine Hahn's character,
yeah.
shadowed our rabbi. And so she came to our, Kol Nidre service right. when we led that service, and she was there, and she's been to a few. And so she shadowed Susan. So she basically, the rabbi in the show is kind of like our rabbi, and a lot of the crew members of Transparent are Jewish.
You know, something I struggle with, mm-hmm. even though I have my hands on the instruments all the time.
Sure.
And even though I'm writing music all the time.
Yeah.
But when I have to go into a very personal, when I have to tune into my truth,
yeah.
I fear that I won't be able to tune into it musically again. As you disconnect from that part of yourself,
mm-hmm.
when you pull away from one thing, do you ever, this is just
sure,
out of
yeah,
curiosity,
yeah.
artistically, are you ever worried that you've lost touch with that thing?
I constantly worry about it with every artistic medium. When I was writing the book, I got to a point where I was really blocked. And I had to turn the book in a month, and I had 30% done of this 500-page book, and I was freaking out. I'm just like, it's not coming. What's happening? And that's when I went to New Orleans and cut off from everything, and I just needed different energies around.
Yeah.
And that's what I think I found has been my remedy whenever I'm in a slump or in that place where I'm blocked or I feel I'm never going to be able to write another song again. It's like you got to, you know, I remove those negative thoughts. You just dig in and do it. And if that still isn't working, it's changing your environment can really help. Working on a routine also really helps me. Like, you know, in New Orleans, I went for a run every morning. I went to the coffee shop I rode, and then I went at night and saw music. And it was just, it became this kind of really healthy, helpful routine for me. And even with songwriting, you know, if something's not working, I'll change it up a little bit. And it's also like getting out into the world.
Do you ever feel, by being connected to so much of what's happening in the business and in the world of music, is it discouraging sometimes? Because it's just you hear so much great music, you hear what's out there, and then you still have to confront your own, you know, creativity in the face of all of that.
Absolutely. I mean, it's, as businessman, I'm very confident and I'm, you know, very outspoken and I'm out there and but at the core, like, I'm still an artist, and there's lots of insecurities that are always coming and going and like mostly coming. I, as the artist, I go through that constantly, and it's not fun. I mean, you know, I've gotten some of my best songs from being in these really difficult places.
Yeah.
I think what I've realized is that there's always going to be someone better than me. There's always going to be a better songwriter, a better singer, a better guitar player, a better trumpet player, a better performer, but there's never going to be another me. And it's like, and that's true for every single artist out there. Again, it's just bringing your own truth.
Yeah.
And no one can bring your truth. Like, they can't give that to the world. There's only one person that can give that.
I mean, the truth is, the reality is that the world is more ready for some people's truth than it is for others. That's where the insecurity, I think, that we all face comes from. Do people care?
Exactly. I think every artist on every level struggles with that. I see my artist friends who are bringing 1,000 people in every city they go to, and they're struggling with that. I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, I would kill to be in that position right now.
Those artists are looking at the next level.
Exactly. They're like, why aren't I touring arenas right now? Yeah. Maybe people don't really care. I've just fooled these 1,000 people in every city or something like that. And unless you're creating a super, 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 super niche sound that really, there's only 12 people on the planet who are going to get into because they, you know, have your exact same background and whatever. I mean, there is...
Well, this is what I've heard. I've read you say this. There's an audience for you.
There's an audience. And the caveat is you do have to get to a level of professionalism. You have to get past the amateur level because, okay... And I see this a lot of the times, and everything I talk about pretty much on Ari's Take and in the book is has the understanding that you're already solid, you know? And so there is a lot of music out there and a lot of artists who are trying to, you know, cart before horse kind of thing. It's just like, okay, you have to get your music solid. You have to get it to the point where you know it's as best as it can be, and it's not just good enough. A lot of artists put out stuff that are just good enough, and good enough actually is awful because it's just mediocre. No one wants mediocrity, and if that's what you're putting out there, it's just, you know, people see right through that, and it's not honest. I mean, really, because it's, and so, you know, that's also like digging in, you know, with some younger artists is like, okay, well, maybe I got to work, you know, get better at guitar. Maybe I have to work on my voice a little bit. Maybe I have to, you know, study songwriting or study these things. And just that's the me time, you know? And so, I think also all artists are very capable and, of having, we're very we have diverse influences.
I mean, particularly now.
Yes, and we're very capable of creating a lot of different kinds of music and in many different styles. I see this all the time, and you know, but the thing is that fans don't realize that, and so I think part of the business and part of helping bring what your putting out in the world to your audience is homing in on exactly what that is, focusing it, narrowing it down.
I find when I am producing people that a big part of what I'm doing is eliminating things.
I love that. And I remember you said that on your conversation
with Michael.
Michael. And I love that. Exactly. It's like creating a record, I think you said. I'm going to horribly quote you back to you. But it was like creating a record is just as much what it's not.
What it isn't. That's exactly
as what
right.
it is.
Because we are also influenced by so much stuff.
Yes.
And if you manage, I think, to find that recipe where you get to mix it up. I mean, you found a recipe in your live shows where you're playing trumpet and you're playing all this kind of percussive guitar stuff and you're beatboxing. And these are all very eclectic elements. But there was a recipe that added up to you.
Yes, yes. But to be honest and to be like totally frank, like that is also something that I've struggled with tremendously in my music career and that I feel like has actually held me back from finding a broader audience is because, okay, that was my live show.
Yeah.
This crazy acoustic looping thing with trumpet in it. It had a sound.
Yeah.
And then my records were drastically different sounding. And that was tough for me because like I initially created these live shows to compensate for not having a band.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, well, I know how to play trumpet. Yeah. I know how to beatbox. I think it would be good if we had a beat here because I'm kind of missing that beat and I'm missing the sounds. And, you know, I can't hire a band every time. So I created it to compensate. And then people started to identify that as my sound. And I'm like, yeah, but I'm not hearing that as my sound. Like, I'm hearing what I'm creating on my records as my sound. And it was totally disjointed.
Well, the record I don't think you made is the studio version of the live show.
Right. It's definitely been tough trying to figure that out because a lot of people would see me live and then they'd get the record or they listen to the record and I'm like, this doesn't make any sense.
but also you are kind of having it both ways in the sense that your record is way more syncable than if you had done a live version, a studio version of your live show.
Right. Totally. I mean, I've gotten syncs from the studio records, not the live ones. Having this understanding, this awareness, just through going through it all and, you know, is helping me with this new project and launching, you know, what this is going to be, but also help guide other musicians. And that's, I guess, become one of the hats that I wear is like, you know, music guide, teacher, whatever you want to call it. It's just like, I guess that's just become a thing where people come to me for advice. I'm like, well, hey, I learned this. And like, this is how.
The hard way.
Yeah, the hard way for sure. And so I've had a lot of time to kind of, you know, evaluate like what aspects of my music career I could have done better. And I think there's been some big ones that prevented me from growing the bass on a level that I could have. That was definitely one of them. Not really understanding what my sound was and not really focusing that. Also really not understanding what my image was. And I think it's more difficult for singer-songwriters than it is for bands, because for bands, you can just kind of come up with something together and you have a palette that you work from as the band, because you kind of have to create that to be a cohesive band. But when it's just a singer-songwriter, it's like, wow, it's just going to be me. But that doesn't really help.
Am I experiencing your artistic image right now?
It's part of the new artistic palette, I would say. But the image is more than just the clothes.
Right.
But yes, I would say my daily life, I've always kind of worn clothes that lent itself to what I was feeling in that moment. So now I've been into a massive 70s influenced phase. And that's where the bell bottoms come out. I mean, the entire record's inspiration is 70s funk and soul. And it was a conscious decision that it's like, okay, I'm going to launch this project and the image has to be on point. Like, it has to be that. And so I feel very comfortable in that. But the image is also more. Also, like the what you present on on your social media, and because that's part of your image too. And so, yes, it's the clothes that you wear, but it's also what you write on your social media, how you write it, you know, what you tweet about, how you Snapchat. It's all of that, and
how you present yourself to the world.
Yeah, it's how you present yourself. And so, you know, the artists that really get that, and the ones that have a very strong handle on that, are the ones that start surpassing their peers who may have better music, or, you know, that's always subjective, maybe stronger musicians, but they don't have as strong a handle on the kind of image that they present to the world.
Ari, thank you for presenting your image to me today.
Thank you.
I feel really like I learned a lot. I really appreciate that you have chosen to share all of this stuff with people, and that it makes you feel good to spread some of this around.
My pleasure. Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me.
There you have it, Ari Herstand. What's the takeaway? Times are pretty good. There's an audience out there, and there will never be another you. After we finished talking, Ari looked at my social media game and gave me a bunch of tips, and he totally schooled me. If you enjoyed this one, you might also enjoy my conversation with record producer Matt Pearson, neuroscientist Dan Levitin, and drummer Dave King. I'll be back in 2 weeks with another one. Until then, I'll talk to you soon.
Yes, I may dream a million dreams, but how can they come true if there will never, ever be another?